Today, I'll show you 7 things that you need to successfully photograph the Milky Way. As the core of the Milky Way becomes more visible at nighttime, you might want to go out and try and take a photograph of it. Where I live, I've got another month before the core becomes visible at night. Normally, the Milky Way season starts at around April and runs right through until about September. So I'm just giving you a checklist of things that you need or that you might want to put on your shopping list before the season starts. Some of these are essential and some of these are optional. But the more that you have, the better your photographs will be and the easier you'll find it to take those photographs. Obviously, you'll need a camera to do this. Some cameras are better than others, but if you know the principles of shooting the Milky Way, you can even get good shots with a point and shoot like this. I use the Sony A7 series cameras. These are full frame cameras, but you don't need them to shoot good pictures of the Milky Way. If you have a crop sensored camera, you can get really good shots. You just might need a wider lens. The first camera I used to get a successful shot of the Milky Way was the Canon 350D. It wasn't the best shot in the world, but it opened my eyes to astrophotography. A fast wide manual lens is great for astrophotography. You don't strictly need one, but it'll make the job a lot quicker and a lot easier. I sometimes shoot with a fly-by-wire lens, but most of the time I'll use my manual focus lenses. I'll make sure I know where the infinity point is by checking it on a far point in the middle of the day. And then, as long as I mark this point or remember where it was, I can easily put it back to this point and keep checking back when I'm shooting at night. And this is by far the best investment you can make if you're serious about astrophotography. You set your focus and set your aperture, and you're done. All you have to do is shine a torch on the top of the lens to check these every now and then. If you're shooting with a crop-sensored camera, you'll need something like a 10 to 12 millimeter lens with the widest aperture that you can afford. If you're shooting with a full frame camera, a 14 to 16 millimeter lens is really good. Basically, I'm talking about wide field astrophotography. So the wider the better. Then you'll get more of the Milky Way in your shot. You can do a pano stitch, but that's a subject for a different tutorial. An app like Photopills or the Photographer's Ephemeris will show you where the Milky Way is in the sky, and you can get the time from the app when it'll be in the position you want it to be. You can also plan around the moon phases with this app. If you're location scouting, as long as you have a signal, you can check to see exactly where it'll be in the sky with the AR function. When planning your nighttime photo shoot, you want to find the darkest location possible nearest to you. If you go to lightpollutionmap.info, this is a great place to start. By using this and Google Maps, you can find the darkest locations near you so that when you're planning your shoot, you'll know where to go to get a good dark sky. Also, depending on where you are on the planet will determine how dark it gets. The closer you are to the Arctic Circle in the summertime for that hemisphere, the lighter the night will be. So these are 2 things to take into consideration when searching for a dark sky. Because there's so little light about, you'll need to keep the shutter open for a really long time. So you'll need to shoot from a tripod. You want to get a good, sturdy tripod. If you get a cheap, plasticky one, the camera might move or you might get some shake in your shot. So do a little bit of research and maybe go down to your local camera shop and see what they have. Again, because you're shooting long exposures, you'll need to keep the camera as still as possible. When using a remote shutter release, this will ensure that you won't touch the camera when pressing the shutter button. You don't need one of these, and if you don't have one, you can put the camera on a self-timer. This will just delay the shutter from opening so you can get your hands away from the camera before it takes the photograph. When shooting under a new moon, you'll need a torch for a couple of reasons. The main one is to see what you're doing. You'll need to see where you're setting up and see what you might be able to get into the foreground. The second reason is that you might want to light paint your foreground. If you're not sure how to do this, click on the eye in the corner. This will take you to another of my videos. Last of all, you'll need clear skies. And this is where patience comes in. You may do all of the planning, find a really good dark location, and then plan for a new moon, but then it's cloudy. I'm quite fortunate that we live in Dubai. We have lots of clear skies, so I have lots of opportunities to shoot the stars. You may live in a place where the weather is a little bit less predictable. So basically get everything else ready to go. So when it is a clear sky on a new moon, you're ready to go and ready to shoot the Milky Way. And that's about it. I'm really looking forward to this Milky Way season. I've got lots of ideas for tutorials, so keep an eye out for them if that's something you're into. I've also got access to a tracker, so I'm looking forward to using this and showing you what I've learnt. As always, if you like what you see, give me a thumbs up. If you didn't, give me a thumbs down. And for weekly tutorials, hints and tips in photography and videography, subscribe and turn on notifications. I'll see you next time.